Her knowledge on Shah Latif is vast, to say the least. She will be spearheading the conversation on redefining Shah Latif and the Latifian concept of Ishq, and I'd like to ask you to give her a resounding welcome as she takes the stage.
कयो मुतालो मुँ हो जो वर्क विसाल जो कयो मुतालो मुँ हो जो वर्क विसाल जो तेमें तू ही तू लात न लहजे जेत्री मैं गर्क हुई पढ़ते पढ़ते वो जो वर्क था विसाल का मैं गर्क हुई पढ़ते पढ़ते वो जो वर्क था विसाल का बस तुम ही तुम थे हर वर्क मिसाल था तेरे नगमाए हुस्न और जमाल का मैडम मेहताब राइटली सेड बिकॉज़ आई एम नॉट एबल टू सी एनीवन इन द ऑडियंस दैट्स गुड दैट देयर इज अ प्रॉपर लाइट ऑन माय पेपर्स आई एम एबल टू सी अ फ्यू वर्ड्स ऑफ ग्रैटिट्यूड आई एम क्वाइट थैंकफुल टू यू फॉर योर काइंड प्रेजेंस इन दिस प्रोग्राम I particularly thank Siraj Institute of Sindh Studies for and his marvelous team, of course, for making me part of this galaxy. Today, SISS has made a delightful combo of intellectuality, of creative intensities. I just emphasize the word intensity because I will be talking today on the intensities of Ishq of Shah Latif. So they have made a delightful combo of intellectual intensities, aesthetic supremacies, and artistic profundities. This celestial combo of arts and aesthetics primarily includes Siraj, a name that is the symbol of credibility and integrity, art and creativity, and both in Sindhi society and Sindhi literature. And then it has Siraj Institute of Sindhi Studies, a think tank that is created in his name. It has Fahmida, it has Mahtab, it has Nurul Huda, it has Anisa, which I call that she has been our team leader, our shepherd today. She has been streamlining all of us. She deserves this. And along with that, it has music, it has dance, and it is supreme, marvelous, many magnificent recitations from Shah Latif. And above all, it has supreme theme that is love, love of Shah Latif Bhitai. And before starting my lecture, I would just make a few points for you. I must mention today, instead of love, I'd be using word Ishq. But there's a little problem in this terminology because English lexis does not have this word. There may be some phrases that could be used. You can say passionate love, you can say ardent love, you can say worshipping love. These are the terminologies that could be used. I would also, along with Latif, will draw analogies with Persian tradition of tasawwuf or mysticism and romantic poetry. Because when we talk about Latif and we don't mention Rumi, the talk is going to be incomplete. So what I think that I have been given ruthless 45 minutes to finish my talk and talking on Latif in 45 minutes. And I think it's just like enclosing ocean into a jar or talking on the history of thousands of years of love into 1 hour or little less. So I'm trying to do that. So initially, I would just speak five points. First is that it's essential to have a philosophical glance at Shah Latif Bhitai because people have been interpreting Bhitai into different lenses, whatever the disciplines they belong to. It is essential at this stage when we are in the 21st century to reinterpret Bhitai into philosophical lens. The first point is that Latifian love has subjective structures. One needs to understand that. It's just not a common-based love that we see in society, that there are young men and women, they fall in love and then that's love. It's far beyond and far deeper than that. So it has subjective structures, it has its own kinds, it has its own nature and relations. It means one can talk about Latifian love both metaphysically and epistemologically. And of course, ontologically too, philosophically, because it has its own structures, tangible or invisible, tangible or visible, or intangible or invisible structures. So it's a complete phenomena, it's a whole subject to study. Ontology of Latif has three main parts. Ontology means its proper structure of Latifian love. It has three main parts. It has the lover, it has the beloved, and it has the love and journey. And there's a rest of diversity of the images of these three parts of that ontology, and an enthralling phenomena of a struggle of meeting and separation, what we call wasl and hijr, and much more than that is in between. Second, we must understand that there's something unique about Latif's love that it distinguishes from the general or societal concept of love. The societal love that we experience or hear or talk about in society, it has its own limited boundary function. It drags one into the quotidian, it drags one into the routines, into the common business. Well, Latifian love, it's just like an ocean. It's several creeks of dimensions, far from routine, mundane experiences of day-to-day life and day-to-day love experiences. Umr sab ishq si punu je puchan. Umr sab ishq si punu je puchan. Risa reza yutin si kujade laikan. Vada tale tin tinja marvaje maran. So she is mere interested. She's not merely interested in meeting. She's not merely interested in the commonplace love. She's interested in the journey, in the journey of the love. This is what Bhattai's tradition of love is, that he doesn't believe mostly into the meeting. That is very early phase of love. So Latifian love has quite intense idealism. Idealism I use here with regards to, in a poetic sense, with regards to creative imagination and fantasy. I don't use idealism with regards to philosophy, or I don't use with regards to idealism versus materialism. There's idealism in Latif's poetry, and it has three premises. Poetry is not poetry unless it carries idealism, unless it portrays idealism or fantasy or creative imagination, or then it generates idealism. It carries, it portrays, and then it generates idealism. Poetry is not poetry unless it is direct and firm and unbreakable relationship with idealism. One. Second, idealism cannot be that genuine or supreme idealism unless it renovates, it changes, it rather transforms your consciousness, your being, your morals, and your characters. Three, that transformation is not the real transformation unless it elevates that being, that consciousness, that moral, that characters from lower to higher strata of wisdom, creativity, and imagination. So in the nutshell, the characters of poet like Latif, they practice the idealism that transforms their consciousness or character from basic to higher levels of wisdom and imagination. And he says unbelievable things. Say what he asks makes me to say. Ucho utahu ghanu jiyan ke tu jabal. Ucho utahu ghanu tu jiyan ke jabal. Marana musihal puthe to andhkya. She's alone. She's walking in front of her this mountain. And then she's talking to mountain. That makes her feel trivialized, because it is gigantic, its magnanimity makes her feel that she's trivial. But how she is talking, and he says, and she says, that whatever the magnanimity you have, and she calls death and says, oh death, come, I want to walk behind you. So Latif is the epitome of fantasy. The fantasy in his poetry offers massive transformation of being and consciousness at magnificent level. His characters this guy practiced this idealism at a superlative level. This is what I want to say, that sometimes it shocks you even, that you cannot believe that this thing can happen in love. So the practice of idealism of his heroes becomes Latifian character, Latifian behavior. So Ishq is the central trait in his poetry. Ishq is actually Latifian behavior. Generally, now coming to the point, it's a little bit technical, but I'm just trying to tell you very simply. This kind of idealism that I just told you, three premises of idealism, if any poet who is using this kind of idealism into poetry, that kind of idealism, when it is portrayed into poetry, it has its own function. It has its own nature. It has its own vernacular. It has its own language. It has its own understanding. Yes, words are also used. It can be explained etymologically, but what makes it supreme is the language of symbols, is a symbolic language or is a sign language. This is why there are volumes of intensity in every act of Latif talks about. Every concept Latif uses is either an intense word or has an intense or piercing meaning. For example, for him, knowing is sagacity, kindness is compassion. His traveling yogis are the voyagers of the endless journey towards the truth. For him, seeking knowledge is no less than going on oceanic or underwater expeditions. Similarly, his love is Ishq. Sacrifice in that Ishq is no less than going on to the gallows or burning in the fire of love like moths or parvanas. In Latif, submitting to the beloved is accomplished into either wine pub or caravan sarai of intoxication. Again, a symbol. Don't take it literally. In his love, either there are gallows or there are abattoirs of love where heads are chopped at the chopping blocks and people happily go there. What is that abattoir? What are those chopping blocks? And what is the meaning of the cutting of head? It's again a symbol. Hence, in a nutshell, Latif's love is a love of sagacious. Latif's love is a love of compassionate, is a love of eternal voyagers, is a love of the seekers of knowledge, is a love of sacrificing souls, is the love of drinkers from the intoxication of love, it's love of the men and women of gallows, is a love of untiring, real, genuine lovers and ashiks. Fourth point. Latif's preliminary stage of love is intense. Latif's love is not the love of the beginner. The pitch of love in Latif, even at the onset is high. It starts with higher stage. It's a love of the one who is quite tested under the burning sun or into the furnace of meeting and separation love. It's not the love of the partially seasoned, it's the love of the heavily seasoned folks who are grilled into the tough monasteries of love or Ishq. There's no space for superficiality in Latif and Ishq. We'll see what he says again to Saswi. He says, Sab koh kare sabka tu khui khanj vikkar. Sab koh kare sabka tu khui khanj vikkar. Tanj manja tikkar ta pant paase bhar nibre. There's a difference between the journey that one does with feet and there's a journey that one does with a heart. And there's a difference between the journey that you are going for a superficial meeting with a lover and there's a difference between the journey that of course for you meeting has several different meanings. Fifth point, very important. In Latif, beloved is not the central character. Generally we believe the beloved to be the supreme character in love, but in Latif it is different. The supreme character here is of Ashik, is of lover, not the beloved. Why? First of all, the beloved in Latif is mostly a man. He's pathetically quiet, wordless, sedentary, dormant, resting, and does not have much role except for that of being sought by the lover. And the lover is the central character in Latif. It's mostly a woman. She's head over heels immersed in Ishq. She's constantly waiting and waiting and waiting for ending the separation with him. She's devoted herself to chant and praise the excellent attributes of that lover, the dormant lover. She's ready to go on a tough journey. The destination is the beloved, the eternal traveler's ultimate focus is the beloved. In Latif's love, the lover has an inexorable focus on the journey towards beloved. So I want to say that, but I want to say the last point, I just want to clarify and then go ahead. The lover, that is the woman, she's a seeker. The beloved is the man who is indifferent. The lover jumps into the adventures, the beloved chooses to stay static. The lover consistently does meditation for uniting with the beloved, and the beloved is almost inactive in the subjective, even in the subjective struggle of love. She sets him on a long, long journey to achieving love, and he's absolutely calm, settled, without any role. If she is Marvi, she rejects the luxuries and riches of Umar in the love of her people or of her land, and he's the kidnapper king. If she's Sasui, poor Punu is so naive, who submitted to be carried away by his siblings, and Sasui sets on a long, long journey to find him. If she's Suni, Mehar is playing fiddle beside his hut at the river, and Suni is swimming through the tumultuous waves of the raging river. And ultimately, when she's drowning, he's lamenting by standing at the bank of the river and says, Darya to te daan in this being. He's lamenting, he says that he curses the river and says that you have drowned my Suni, and I will talk to the God, to God on the day of judgment. So he's waiting for the day of judgment. And she sacrificed. If she's Mumal, she's devastated by her separation from Rano, and Rano doubts her fidelity and faithfulness. Man. Samundri, if it is Samundri, Kahori or Ramkali, their women are waiting for the company and companions of their beloved men who leave for unknown journeys, for unknown times. So in Latif and Ishq, the woman is the brave character, she's a lover, she's the ashik, and who goes on adventurous expeditions, and the man in most of the so. And the man on most of the source very diplomatically tries his level best to play very safe. So mostly in his source, Latif talks about the ashiks and lovers exploring unique dimensions of love. Take any sort of Latif, be that Kalyan or Yaman Kalyan or Asa or Suni or Saswi, Mumal, Kedaru, Dahar, Ramkali, Kaori, Pirbhati, Saran. There is a lover on the journey of love, and the journey is endless, and there's a diversity in the kinds and images of and nature of the beloved and destination. There's a variety of the definitions of beloved. So in Latif, the beloved is human, but at some stages, at some places, you see the beloved is a focus, it's an objective, it's an aim, it's a cause, it's a phenomenon, it's a state of mind, it's a very commonplace tiny thing that we call a thorn, a camel. It can be anything. So mostly the beloved could be a being or non-being. It does not make any difference. So much so the journey is important, the quest for the destination is important, and the intense form of self-dedication and devotion is important. Now coming to Suni. I have chosen five or six sources I would talk about briefly. Those sources. The beloved is Mehar, the buffalo herder. She's in love, she's daring, audacious, ready to sacrifice herself in love by entering deep waters even the mid of nights, relying on broken and half-cooked jar. Vah tikh, vahura tikh, jit nih tikh nirali. Vah tikh, vahura tikh, jit nih tikh nirali. Jankhe ishq amigaj se khilwat khyali. Variye se wali hiyano jinin hat. So here Suni compares the tumultuous current of the river with the flow of love. And she says the flow of river or creeks or streams is also swift, but the flow of love or ishq is far swift, so that it's uncontrollable, it's so unbridled, that keeps the lover's inner deep quiet into meditation and seclusion. And she evokes divinity, that, oh divine, bring those back to me who have hold my heart. Because love takes the spirit to the boiling and burning incinerators, ovens, and the similar thought we read in Rumi too. He says, Ishq joshad bahar ro manind deeg. Ishq joshad bahar ro manind deeg. Love causes the sea to boil like the boiler. Ishq soyad kuhera manind reeg. And love grinds the mountain like sand. People from Iranian translate are here. And I think they may decide very well that how I am pronouncing Tehrani accent, the right or wrong. Coming back to Sunni. Bhago, gharo bhago to ghoryo paana vayo hijab. Gharo bhago to ghoryo paana vayo hijab. Vajit vadi vujudame rayo ruh rabab. Sahar liye sawab am ghano I ghoryaan. Now imagine. Now see, it's important to understand the scene, to capture the scene exactly that Bhutai is portraying. She said, she's in the waters, the jar is half cooked, it breaks into pieces. And she says, a blessing if the jar broke up. It's a blessing. Rather, it was a barrier or parda between me and my lover. My body in love of Mihar is vibrating. Vajit vadi vujudame rahyo ruh rabab. And says, my body in love of Mihar is vibrating, my soul is playing like violin. My whole being pulsates with this music of love. Without being the beloved, I even shun the goodness that is willed by God. Again, and this is the amazing, amazing couplet. Syari taharat me jaghri vasande miha. This is the heaviest ever line I have read in Bhutai. Syare taharat me jaghri vasande miha. Now imagine, sometimes Sunni is speaking, sometimes Bhutai himself is speaking. How he portrays the scene. On the one hand, it's a ruthless winter. In just one line, it's a ruthless winter. It's so cold, and then it's night, and she's in the water swimming, and the rain is pouring. Syare taharat me jaghri vasande miha. Halo the pasu suni jakar blani niha. Jenke rato dih mehari maname. So on the one hand, it's ruthless winters, and Sunni enters the deep waters in the midst of the cold night. On the other hand, rain is pouring out. Latif says, let's go and meet that Sunni. She knows the etiquettes of love. She doesn't care. She doesn't care about the night. She doesn't care about the winter. She doesn't care about the broken jar. And she doesn't care about the pouring rain. Hello, tapasu Sunni. Jaakar jaane nih jake raato dih mehari maname. So let's go and meet Sunni, because she has etiquettes of love, who is day and night constantly absorbed into the memory of her beloved Mihar. Now coming to Sasri, because we have short time, that I have to jump from one suit to another. Now see what Latifi expects from Sasri. I just deliberately chosen two different kinds of couplets that define two different kinds of journeys that Bhutai expects from Sasri. Khuhi ja khayain vikhat hai veji kai. Now just imagine, you would say Bhutai was ruthless, why he was expecting this much callousness at the time when she's really fallen. When Sasri is too exhausted to walk, imagine her fallen on the ground with closed eyes. She's not even able to raise her head, later on taking a step. That time Bhutai expects from her. So in that condition, he asks her that not only rise, get up Sunni, and not only rise, but take a swift step. And you don't have to walk on the plain land, you have to cross the mountain. In that condition, when you are almost dead, at that time he expects from Sunni to get up and walk swiftly and cross the mountain. And only then, she's getting closer to the beloved. And the next is totally different. Here he demands the physical struggle from Sasri. Now he wants her to walk with heart. He advises Sasri to go on spiritual journey. He says, Dur, Dur Matu Doraj. Dur Matu Doraj is Sabur Karma Sasui. Puran Chad Peran Si Vihan Visarej. Sukhan Ja Sayed Che Laga Pa Lahej. He is San Halej Pandu Pasi Bandre. Latif neglects physical quests and search of Punnu by crossing long distances of journeys. He asks her, why to follow footprints of the beloved? Punnu, he says, do not quit search, but quit relationship with the comforts. This is a journey to be begun by heart and not by feet, then the distance comes to an end. So in Latif's love, there are stages. What I understand, going on a physical journey is the early stage, and going on the journey of heart is the higher stage. The more the doors open, there starts subjective journey, which is the journey of heart, which is the journey of the spirit. That's the highest journey. So opening the closed doors is essential. This is what we're telling us. Because love cannot enter into the closed doors. And again, I'm bringing Rumi. Tato dar band khishtan boshi. Tato dar band khishtan boshi. Till the doors are closed on you. Till the doors of love, of course. Till the doors are closed on you. Talk of the love is equal to speaking falsehood. Is speaking fallacies. Tato dar band khishtan boshi, ishq bui durusan boshi. Now see what he expects from Mumal, coming to Mumal Ramasur. Mumal is the princess of Kak Mahal. She's alone. As Rano, her beloved has left her under the suspicion of infidelity. Since he left, there's a relentless turmoil in the mansion on the palace of Kak, which is the Kak Mahal. The trees which were green have shrunken, they have withered, the environs of the mansion is boiling, its floor, walls are burning, and the love of Rano has eaten Mumal's heart out. Because he has doubted her fidelity, he has doubted her faithfulness. Since Rano left, everything in the mansion sounds dead to Mumal, and she's trying to invoke powers of love. She says, Hal Kurban, Mal Kurban, Ghorya Lagano. Hal Kurban, Mal Kurban, Ghorya Lagano. Moyan si ma, pitalana fakir jo shala russe marano. Moyan si mano, munasib nahi mendra. So Mumal is addressing her beloved and she asks her that she would sacrifice herself, her possessions, her assets and everything she has, even the kingdom of Lagano. She will sacrifice that. She will sacrifice her kingdom. She presents herself to her beloved as a beggar. In love, it's of course a Persian tradition as well. You present yourself before your beloved. In this absence, she feels herself already dead and says, how can the beloved be annoyed with the dead? Since in love, in the separation, she's already dead, how the Rano is annoyed with the dead? Muyansi Mano Munasib Nahi Mendra. So this is the dedication of Mumal. Now coming to Prabhati, when I'm saying that it's not necessary the beloved is just a human being. In Prabhati, he talks about the unique characteristics of someone who is into music. He says, Serandiya saaz kayo sumin sari raat. Serandiya saaz kayo sumin sari raat. Jajkani zaat age na hui. Jaj kaani zaat iya na hui agahi. Age iya na heer una dar sandhi mangane. Age iya na heer una dar sandhi mangane. Jindrigha kare peer sanyu ratin sumi. So you stay asleep till dawn with your musical instrument lying beside you. You have a musical instrument, you have a violin or flute or any other musical instrument is lying beside you and you're sleeping. It's not forgivable. The Jajik people or the Jajikani troubadours or Jajikani musicians or Jajikani singers or minstrels, they never acted like that. The singers, the troubadours at the beloved's door never had a habit of sleeping tranquil like a log for whole the night. Jani sukh naah ko charna se chajan. Jani sukh naah ko charna se chajan. Runyan raah puchan mathe kulhan ki nara. They alone are called the real troubadours, the people of music, the people of songs who are not acquainted with sleep. They wander about in the wild lands with their musical gadgets hanging on their shoulders. And they're inquisitive about the weird destination they never knew about before and no one knows about those destinations. Ajaban, namaze mastane to bigu durastastan. It's a very strange prayer of your mastana ashik. Tell me, is it true? Ajab namaze mastane to bigu durastastan ki na donad uzamani na shinasar uzamani. He's asking that there's a very strange prayer of your mastana ashik. Ashiki and mastana are directly proportional to each other. So there's a strange prayer of your mastana ashik. Tell me, is that correct? That when they pray or when he prays, he forgets about the time and he forgets about the space. Ajab namaz mastane to bigudurastastam ki nadanad uzamani na shinasad umakam. Now coming to Surasa. And the beloved is sagacious, is skillful, and see Latif's expectation. Mehrumai marivya mahirati namoa. They died unskilled. They could not die dexterous. They could not die wise. They could not die skillful. Mehrumai marivya mahirati namoa. Chiri jiya chunjani ladyaun loa. Hubabai hua unhe wadhiya vichani. Latif, the examples of those who died deprived, who could not die skillful, who could not die wise. And he uses a simile of a sparrow, a simple, small, tiny bird, and says, like a sparrow, they came into the world, they picked a few grains into their beak from the heap, a big heap, and they ceased to exist. So those people came into the world, they could not know the mysteries of the world, they were like bubbles of water into the ocean. They cease to exist. And then what he expects from teachers, which are not commonplace teachers like us, he expects Oryai Aadin Medio Mollima Khabru. Oryai Aadin Medio Mollima Khabru Sata Sudhnadin Jitvah Vedhakare. So he says the so-called teachers are Mollimi. They go and bring information from the seashores, just from the seashores. They are the people of the seashores, since they do not enter into the deep waters. They do not know the stories of the midstreams where careless gushes flow in the heart of the ocean. They don't know that story or the mid of the streams. Now coming to Sur Kalyan and Yaman Kalyan, a couplets from there. When the lover is in the pain and he or she doesn't want to invoke healer. Andha undha vedya khal kujarya khaniye. Andha undha vedya khal kujarya khaniye. Asa lukhi dilame tu pyariye pedi surya jani se maran tini mushaido. Oh, you ignorant, you oblivious doctor. There is pain of love and you burn my skin. I'm already in physical anguish and you push me to drink the medicinal concoction. To me, the gibbets or gallows are like nuptial bed, where death is nothing but the union with the beloved. Asari Bolino. I would happily forget Khusro here. Asari Bolino man barfiz en nadan tabi. Asari Bolino man barfiz en nadan tabi. Dardmande ishq ra daru bejuz di darnis. Oh, unwise doctor or physician, get away from my pillow. Don't stand from my head. There's no therapy or remedy for those who are stricken by love. All they need is just the sight of the beloved. Rabu thiu rabab vadyan vel sabkeh. Rabu thiu rabab vadyan vel sabkeh. Luchan kuchan nathyo jab. Luchan kuchan nathyo jan buriye jawab. Ma all veins tremble constantly in beloved's love like a stream of violin. Man change to am. Rumi. Man change to am bar har rage man tu zakhm zani man tan taranam. I'm your violin and you hit or strike in every kill of my vein and vibrate and I vibrate, I pulsate. Rabu thu rabab vajan vel sab kahin luchan kuchan nathyo janvariye jabab soi sarinam supri kais jay kabab soi an azab soi rahat roj. I'll read it again. Man change to am bar har rage man tu zakhm zani. The second last part, when the lover is a yogi or ascetic or a mystic and the beloved is unknown. He talks about, Bhitai, Latif, talks about the 12 days of sohbat or company. with the ascetics or yogis, most probably in Bhittai's own experience, he observed them for 12 days continuously, being with them. He was a very young boy at that time, Bhittai. He observed them, that the yogis were wearing dust and cinders on their saffron color attire. They were with long hair and were never normal. They breathed in love. They were secretive, who secretly traveled from place to place, stayed at unknown abodes of pilgrimages, ate very little from begging, stayed humble with folded hands, stayed quiet. Khamoshi, maini on dorat, kitar kuftan mini ayat. Silence is more meaningful than conversation, or what silence carries, words cannot carry, or conversation cannot carry. So they lit fire and sat beside the fire with blazing glow of having a vision of beloved. They know amazing and novel meanings of love, ishq, and also of fire. There is a captivating saffron glow on their faces. Love kindled ecstatic beauty into their eyes. They meditate and have been sleepless. They meditate and have been sleepless, and they have overwhelming commotion in their mind. They're consumed. Why commotion in their mind? Because they're consumed by fire of love. They never show that off. But I doesn't believe in showing that off. They have reveries of having sight of beloved, and they are nearing the marvelous union, and at last they united with the beloved. Deh dehai nah jit peer na pakhyan. Deh dehai nah jit peer na pakhyan. Tite khawdyan varadei vana chundya. Jitna pakhi a peer tite timke bahiri. Jitna pakhi a peer tite timke bahiri. Biobari do keer khawr ki a kheeri. Dothi sa loreen ja jui sui na budhi. Pasa mathe pahane khawri khodin. Vidya ut vodi. Vidya ut vodin jit nehat naka. Latif talks about unknown lands where fire is set high at a place where even birds cannot reach. Now, who are they who have kindled the fire on no man, at no man's land, or people of uncommon territories? They launch their khimas at the inhospitable mountainous surroundings. They search for their spiritual knowledge in the boundless zone. And he says, Nuri and Nari. Now this is a woman again talking. Nuri and Nari, Jogira Jahaname, Bari Janmari, Auna Jani Unari. Again, a woman defines characteristics of her traveling beloved. She mentions of the two types of nomadic ascetics in the world. There are Nuris, who have illuminating light of love and sight. And there are Naris, who have illuminating fire of love and sight. And then she says, how can she love without her Nuri and Nari beloved, who give light to the world but burning themselves? Who burn themselves and give light to the world. Hence, burning is important. Fire is important. Secrecy is important in asceticism, in tasawwuf. Meditation is important, and sometimes asceticism is also important. Modesty is important. Simplicity is necessary. Traveling is indispensable. Lighting is essential. And uniting with the beloved is important in nutshell. Ishq is indispensable. Now coming to the last part. The last but not the least. In the beloved is unity into diversity. Vahdata kasrat thi kasrat vahdat kul. Vahdata kasrat thi kasrat vahdat kul. Hakku hakiki hekru. Bia mooliyam abhul. Huhula chuhul. Bila salus sandhu salyani. There's multiplicity. There's plurality which springs from the unity. Then Latif says both unity and plurality originate from infinity. Now whatever you name it God. You name it nature, you name it divinity, or call it something else coming out of something, or nothing coming out of nothingness. There is inexorable unity. The diversity is mere misleading. It's merely a speculation. Ek kasar dar lakh kodi kans girkhyun. Ek kasar dar lakh kodi kans girkhyun. Jinah kaya parkh tera sahib saamu. This cosmos is like a huge citadel, huge mansion with zillions of doors and windows. Wherever I glance, I have a vision of my beloved. Kode kayaun tunju likhan lakha hazar, jeev sabke hai jeesi darsan dhar udhar, prema to japar, kehra jai kehra jaan. Oh beloved, you have manifestations innumerable forms of manifestations. Your spirit, your essence is present in every being. Yet the images, acts and performance of being are not the same. They are unique. O love, how would I say your immeasurable attributes? Jam yek nuras magar rang hali mukhtalif. Jam yek nuras magar rang hali mukhtalif ikhtilafi darmiyani in or on andahte. The light in the whole is the same, but its shades and hues are different. He himself has caused variances between this and that. Now, two definitions of Lovage. They are very strange, they are very marvelous. And the first one is too mysterious, but I'm explaining. Aashiq macho unake, makhi jo maashuk. Aashiq macho unake, he's neither the lover nor the beloved. Aashiq macho unake, makhi jo maashuk. Khalik cho makhamatu, makhi jo makhluk. Salaj tahi sluk, jo naqisan ninyo. So, now this is the definition of love. One of the definitions of love, of beloved, which I define. Do not call him lover, nor the beloved, or you juvenile, you immature. Do not label him as the maker or the creator or the originator of this world. Neither he is a creature. What is he then? Is a mystery? What is the message of Bhitai then here? So that is the only one can understand this mystery who are at the highest stages of consciousness or at highest stages of knowledge or even morals or even character. Pani jal jalalu, there's another definition. In the first definition, he says he's neither this nor that. In the second definition, he's saying opposite, that he's this and he's that and he's everything. Pani jal jalalahu, pani jan jamal, pani surat priyanji, pani husn kamal, pani peer murid the, pani paan khayal, sab saboi hal, manjhai malum the. Again, a new definition of beloved. Previously he said he's neither this nor that, now he says he's this and he's that and he's everything. The beloved possesses. He's majestic. He himself is beauty. He's the guide, he's the follower. Everyone's contemplation would give evidence that all is nothing but his manifestation. Murghishi. Murghishi, Sidhishi, Damhish. Sadrakhishi, Farshakhishi, Bamkhish. Yourself are the bird, you are the prey, you are the trap, you are the snare. Yourself are the seat, you are the ground, you are the balcony. I'll conclude with Bhitai's poem, but before Bhitai, I would read something from Diwani Kabir. Yare mara, ghare mara. Yare mara, ghare mara, ishq jigar khare mara. Yaar toi, ghar toi, khwaje nigadar toi, qatr toi, behar toi, lutf toi, qahar toi. You are the drop, you are the ocean, you are the blessing, you are the curse. Qatr toi, behar toi, lutf toi, qahar toi, qand toi, zahar toi, bhishma yazar mara. You are the sweet, you are the poison, don't give me this much pain. Hujray khurshid tui, khonay nahid tui. You are the place of sun. You are the place of bright star. Rozay umid tui, yarday rahmara. You are the tomb of hope. O beloved, show me the path. Dawne tui, dawn tui. You are the prey. You are the trap. Bode tui, jam tui. You are the wine. You are the bowl. Pukhte tui, kham tui, kham de magzar mara. You are the complete, you are the incomplete, and don't let me pass incomplete. So he, so who, so ajal, so Allah, so pre, so pasah, so veri, so waharu. Finally, I'll end with this thought that he says he's this, he's that, he's the destroyer, he's the creator, he's the beloved, and also he's the breath of life, he's the adversary, and at the same time, he's the leader, he's the manager. Thank you so much.